Hey everyone, welcome back to Pine Hollow Auto Diagnostics. Guess what special car is back? It's the 91 Audi Quattro 20 valve turbo Avant, the super rare exotic blast from the past, Euro style. So the car's running great. The customer brought it back for some much needed maintenance. Timing belt, water pump. He wants to get the air conditioning working, so it's gonna be here for probably a couple weeks while we iron out those things. Otherwise, the car is driving amazingly well. He's been using it daily, which is really impressive. A lot of people were doubting that you can use something like this as a daily driver, but if you're motivated enough and you keep up on your maintenance, not a problem. So let's see what the customer brought. Like I said, you give me the parts and we'll install them. We got some boxes here. So last year, the customer actually removed the fuel tank. If you remember, it was super rusty and nasty inside, and we cleaned it the best we could, but the fuel pump was still not quite happy. It was still eventually clogging up. So he dropped the entire tank and sent it out to be professionally cleaned and coated inside and out. So that problem has been resolved. I can show you a couple pictures. So the customer sent me pictures of the tank. I guess he has an Audi Q7, so this is the gas tank from the 91 Quattro. And that's what it looks like, all coated and nice on the inside. So that's nice to know that that problem has been resolved for good. All right, let's see what we have in our boxes here. So earlier this year, the owner told me he was actually ready to take this thing to the track and have some fun with it. And it threw a warning on the dash that it was overheating or something wrong with the cooling system. But the temperature gauge stayed normal and the fans were cycling on and off. So he's like, what the heck? This sensor, this fancy thermo switch, four pins, he said it was full of coolant, and this is what controls the little warning display on the dash. So he replaced this with an updated three-pin unit, so that's been working fine. And then he noticed that the water pump actually started leaking a bit. So in box number one, we have a brand new water pump, an idler pulley, and timing belt right here. So that's all done together. It's about a 4-hour job. Looks like the customer also brought the full 3 volumes. Look how thick these books are. Factory repair manual for the Audi 100 and 200. So that'll definitely come in handy when doing the timing belt, because on all data, the instructions are very, there are no pictures or anything. So we'll take advantage of that. Also, his airbag light was on because he was missing a component under the rear bench seat. This is called a voltage transformer, so we can try to plug this in, see if the airbags like blow up or something. And then for the air conditioning, looks like we have an orifice tube, new compressor, and a receiver dryer accumulator. But I told the owner that could be opening up a can of worms, because this is an R12 system. If he wants to convert it to R134A, again, it's a lot of variables there. But we can install the new components and see if it works. Put in the appropriate PAG oil. Nothing to lose, really. So that's where we are with the Audi Quattro. Let's get to work. We can start with the easy stuff, plug that in. And I also have VCDS with the 4-pin adapter. So I want to see if we can get live data out of this thing, because we couldn't last time. We were just counting flashing check engine light, blinks. But if we can get live data, that would be pretty sweet. So here we are. This is under the rear seat.
And here's the plug for that voltage transformer that was missing. So that goes in here like that. And the plug looks like goes in from the bottom like so. Looks like it should reach, so I'm just gonna plug it in. Okay. And this thing should slip in here. I don't know if we'll have to remove anything to get it in. Oh. Almost. Almost. There we go. Alright, well, let's see if the airbag light is still on or not. There's the airbag light. Yes, it is still on. Now, I don't know if he reconnected the airbag in here. We'll deal with that later. So from last time, we actually left the driver's airbag disconnected. So let's plug that in and see if the warning light turns off. All right, the orange plug is plugged in. Let's see. Let's just fire it up. Okay, it's still, airbag light's still on. So, to do any further testing, we need a special Audi airbag tester, which I don't have. So, oh well. Alright, so just for kicks, I'm connecting to the diagnostic port. I have the VCDS Rostec OBD2 4-pin adapters. So this is the power and ground, and this is the communication K-line, I guess. And this thing works. This is amazing. Now my question is, can we get live data? So we had three, you know, intermittent codes there. So let's see if we can set close, select, engine. We should be able to see measuring blocks. So fault codes, boom, done, go back, measuring blocks. So, not available, not available. So we have 10 measuring blocks here. What do those mean? I'm guessing we have to look up exactly what those mean. Wow, graph. Okay, so there are the measuring blocks right there. Let's just see. I mean, this is really primitive live data, but if we start the engine, let's see if these change. Okay, so here are the measuring blocks. Let's fire it up. Yeah, that's pretty cool. They are changing. We have 10 measuring blocks. And what are the measuring blocks? I have no idea. Let's see if is one of them like creeping up. That must be the temperature. See if we raise the RPMs up. So that must be the RPMs, 2100 RPMs, 900 RPMs. That's pretty neat, but
Yeah, that's cool. So the red is the engine temperature, I'm sure. It's slowly going up. That's neat. Let's try clearing the codes out. Yes. Okay. Yeah, that worked. Okay. So pretty cool, but still primitive, and you need to know the translation of these measuring blocks. So in the Bentley manual, volume 1 for the engine code 3B turbo, I found the live data kind of translations or what it means. So there are the three diagnostic connectors, power and ground, and the brown connector is our data transfer, and the blue is just for the check engine light, you know, to blink codes. So here we go. Channels 1 to 10, that's exactly what we saw. What do these channels mean? Channel 1, there's a displayed value and then what it actually corresponds to. So these are all 0 to 255 and the actual value. So channel 1 is going to be engine temperature. Channel 2, engine load. Channel 3, engine speed. So we're right about that. And then we have idle stabilizer operating range, characteristic curve 0 point, load adaptation, characteristic curve control. Then we have oxygen sensor control. That's like the closed loop, 123 to 133, and oxygen sensor adaptation. And then finally, channel 10 is a momentary ignition angle. So it tells you what, you know, the value should be, and if there's an issue, if it's greater than 215 or less than 184, then possible faults, and you need to do the checks manually. So that's the load. So basically, the load is like the map sensor reading. 3 is our engine speed, air leaks. So pretty primitive stuff. This may or may not be helpful in actual diagnostics. I mean, it's better than nothing, but compared to, say, GM of this era, this is like, you know, dinosaur level. At least GM gives you real values and real units on live data. This only has 10 data PIDs, and you have to decipher them, go from the whatever this number to an actual number right here. But still, pretty neat stuff, and the fact that this manual has every little detail is amazing. So it's finally time to tear into the Audi Quattro Avant. So to get to this timing belt and water pump, we need to make some room in the front end. Let's take a look at the manuals, see what the easiest way to make some room is. This is the intercooler. Then there's an auxiliary radiator down there. We need to get to that harmonic balancer. I'm sure all the hardware is going to be pretty well seized, so I want to get an impact on there. Let's see how to start tearing this thing apart. So these repair manuals are gold. So the front bumper cover actually looks like it's just held on by two bolts. Well, that should be a good starting point. And then this whole radiator support apparently is held on by only a few bolts. Once we have that off, it's amazing access to the front of the engine. To remove the headlights, apparently there are some clips for the grill So you can get those off, and then the bumper cover. So let's tear into it. So here's one of the bumper cover bolts. It's an 8mm hex. Yeah, right. Let me get a breaker bar. So this one seems to have loosened up. Sweet. Okay. There's one long bolt. Let's get the other one. Alright, see bolt number two. Hey, no problem. Okay. How does this whole bumper just, does it move off? Yeah, it is moving forward. Try to get that off and start peeling back this German onion. Anything else holding us back? Cars were this easy to remove the cover. Oh, there's a wire here. I think it's an aftermarket radar system or something. Well, I'm gonna make the executive decision. We're gonna cut this aftermarket whatever radar detector right here, and then we can remove the bumper easily. Now I think we can remove the bumper. Ah, so much better. Oh. Got this ridiculous chrome strip off. It's held on by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 bolts. And this weather stripping is quite brittle, so it's tight to get a screwdriver in here and unscrew it from the car. But it's off, so we're getting somewhere. Man, this onion is a little stuck. So, trying to get this pipe off of this intercooler solid pipe, and obviously everything is completely aged together. I'm just trying to break the seal between the rubber hose and the metal pipe. Once we do that, we can swing this out of the way. You know, this contraption, but the hose clamp, you can see right there, it's impossible to reach and it's rounded off, it's rusted in. And to take the intercooler off, you have to take the grill off, and take the grill off, everything is so dry and brittle. I don't know what exactly to do. The instructions make it look so easy, but it is not, because these strips go all the way. This is like one massive strip all the way around. How are you supposed to remove that? Take the headlights and the grill off together. The two bolts there. Oh, this is crazy. Maybe the whole assembly just comes off. One bolt there, one bolt there. So if the headlight comes off and everything's attached to the headlight assembly, do we have a chance? It is like one massive puzzle. Well, I got the grill off and these strips. I mean, I don't really know if they're meant to come off the headlights, but how are you supposed to take this apart? these plastic little nibs, they're all basically disintegrating. So I guess the headlights can stay, but it is what it is. All right, so it looks like we're close, but the thing that's hanging us up is this intercooler pipe is clamped to the intercooler, and it's all trapped by this cross member here in the front. So how do we remove the entire thing if we can't get to that hose clamp? Well, I'm going to try to undo the intercooler. It's just this one fancy bolt here. And okay, so that's moving. I got this hose off right here. So the intercooler needs to move that way to get off of these holders, and the pipe is off right here. And we can take these bolts out completely, I guess, and just shove the whole thing that way and maybe pivot it out so the pipe can come out with the intercooler, or at least we can get to the hose clamp somehow. We'll see. I really can't believe this is taking so long just to get to the front of the engine here. So I want to get these suckers out, little pipe holders. Okay, they're out. Now, can we move sideways? What's holding us back now? Okay, so now the intercooler and the pipe are trapped by this cross member. Can we just pull the cross member out with everything? This wiring harness is over it, and then it attaches to this radiator. I can't get to this bolt because it's covered by the intercooler pipe. So you can see it's like a massive puzzle that can only be taken apart one way. Let me keep wiggling some stuff, see if anything happens. Well, I don't know if this is progress. This thing has to come out one way or another. Okay, so now the pipe and the intercooler are basically around the cross member. Is there enough room to squeeze the pipe out? No, no way. So now we're basically trapped here, but we can get to that rusty hose clamp, maybe undo that, and separate the pipe from the intercooler. And that's what I'm going to do next. Well, I actually managed to get the rusty hose clamp loose, and this is crazy. So the whole thing, it's like metal two halves, metal brackets that hold the plastic or the metal pipe to the plastic intercooler. It's all crusty, but we're going to see. Things will separate. Something friendly. Maybe I should take the hose clamp the entire way so I can squeeze these metal pieces out. I basically have to grip this with the Scotty Kilmer pliers and do that. Maybe I should mark it where it fits for easier reassembly. Mark everything. When you're taking something apart, just mark it. You will thank yourself later. So, like that. Good enough. This is a miracle. Got the clamp off. It's actually moving. Just be very careful. You don't want to break the intercooler, because that would be game over for this car. That would be a big no-no. So I'm just gonna try to loosen this up, break up some of the rust, and then just wiggle, wiggle, wiggle. Oh, come on, baby. You got it. Nice. Hooray. Minor victory. Look, we're starting to see some light here at the end of the tunnel. So I think I will remove the crossmember just to make things a lot easier. We're replacing the AC compressor too. So now we have some working room. All right, we're draining all of the coolant out, taking off this auxiliary radiator. It'd be a good thing to do another coolant flush. Level is going down pretty quick. Oh man, it's peeing. Nice. All right, next up, I want to buzz off this bumper support. Sweet. So these things just come out and the whole bar comes off, and then we'll have nice working room. Alternator belt is off, power steering belt is off. So the only thing holding on this plastic timing cover is one out of two little retainers. A little crusty there, but that comes off. And there it is. There's one of the prizes. Pretty skinny belt. There's the water pump. So definitely good time to change it. Yeah, I don't know. We have a new roller. We have to get this harmonic balancer off. That's going to be the tricky part. And let's see where the mark is. On this sprocket. I see a little dot right there. That might be it. There's a pointer right there. So we want to be at TDC when we pull the harmonic balancer off, because that comes with the actual timing gear. And the tensioner here, the tensioner is the water pump, believe it or not. So you see it has like a groove. So the whole water pump is the tensioner. Insanity. All right, I want to see if little RevStark has any chance of removing this big bolt. Nope. Okay. We have to use some more serious tools here. Let's give the big earthquake a chance. Nope. That's what I was afraid of. Air gun. Yes. Woo, corrosion. It's hot. Okay, that's loose with the sprocket. Let me make sure the engine's at TDC. Right here. Alright, next little roadblock here. This little cover. We got one bolt out. The other one is kind of hiding behind the harmonic balancer, and it's rusty and it's not moving. So I got the dot lined up here, and I found the mark right there that lines up with a little pointer. So it's at TDC, number one cylinder. So I feel comfortable just buzzing the big bolt out and taking off the harmonic balancer. Let's blow all this junk out of here. That smells interesting. And I believe the timing gear wants to come off with the, yes, it's attached. So there's definitely a locating Woodruff key. I just want to move this to the side so I can get this bolt out, so we can get this cover off, and then we can just take the whole thing off in one piece. I'm really loving this MAP gas torch. Just heated that bolt up a little bit, boom, right out. So just make sure you don't burn any plastic or rubber. So we're off. We gotta read some instructions. Water pump actually looks pretty good. It might have been leaking from the backside where it seals up against the engine block though.